It's no wonder that so many people get confused by the terms nearsightedness and farsightedness. These terms are often so oversimplified that they just don't make sense in real world use cases. In this video, I'll explain what it truly means to be nearsighted and what it means to be farsighted. Hi, I'm Martin Oguzie and this is Martin's Eye Tips. Thank you for joining me. On this channel, we're all about bringing you eye care tips, how-to videos and product reviews, all designed to help you see better, see more comfortably and be less anxious about your eyes. Now, if you haven't done so already, please consider subscribing to the channel and also hitting the like button and the notification bell as well. That way you get reminded every time I release a new video. So let's get started with today's video, all about nearsightedness and farsightedness. Now, nearsightedness and farsightedness are two terms that we use to explain the error that can occur in the shape of the cornea that leads to light focusing in front of the retina if you're nearsighted, or behind the retina if you're farsighted. Now, let's make sense of these terms before we go any further. Nearsightedness is often also referred to as being short-sighted or being myopic. And it basically refers to the fact that light focuses in front of the retina, and you can think of it as having sight for short distances. Farsighted, on the other hand, is also referred to as being long-sighted or being hyperopic. And this is when light focuses long or behind the retina. And you can think of this as having sight for longer distances, which then also means that in theory, you have problems seeing close up, but you're fine seeing further away. Now, these terms then cause confusion because they don't always make sense, particularly if you're somebody with farsightedness. In the case of nearsightedness, it generally does apply and does make sense. So think of nearsightedness, as I said before, as being having sight for short distances. So people who are nearsighted usually find that their vision for further away things will be blurred to some degree, depending on how short-sighted or how nearsighted they are. Whereas they will always have good clarity of vision close up. And this applies even later on in life as well, again, depending on how much nearsightedness that they have. Now, if you're farsighted and under the age of 40, then you'll probably find that if you've got a prescription that's about plus 2 or less, that you can generally focus well in all distances. So the term farsightedness may not make any sense to you whatsoever because it just doesn't impact you in that way. Now, if on the other hand, you are over 40 and you are farsighted, you may well find that the opposite is true. You may not be able to see very well for close-up things or things very far away. Now, the reason for this is because when we all get to about age 40, we start to have problems with our focusing close up, and this affects our ability to be able to compensate for our long-sightedness or our far-sightedness. And as a result, we start to find then that it affects us far away, but also we start to have problems with close up as well. So it tends to be a little bit of a double whammy at this stage in life. Now, I've made a previous video about presbyopia. If you want to check that out, please check out the link in the top right corner. And the other confusing aspect of it when you're farsighted is that regardless of age, if you have a high prescription, you generally may find that you struggle close up as well as farsighted as well. So while the term is supposed to mean that you have sight for far distances, and this can be true, but it has the exception of your age and also how much farsightedness you have. So what is it that's going on in the eye in both cases that explains what we've just described? Now, in both cases of nearsightedness and farsightedness, they're neither diseases, but it's an error in the curvature of the cornea. In the case of nearsightedness, the cornea is more curved than it ought to be. As a result, it has more focusing power of the light. So when the light hits the cornea, it focuses it so much that it falls short of the back of the eye, short of the retina. And the further away that it falls in front of the retina, the more short-sighted that you are. And in this case, the distance on the far side will be blurry, and this applies in all cases. So even if it's slightly in front of the retina, it will cause a noticeable reduction in clarity and focus to the person viewing. Now, when light falls in front of the retina, there's not much that the eye can do in response to try and correct things for you. That's why even a small amount of nearsightedness will leave somebody quite blurred. And on the test chart, about every 0.25 of power will lose you about a line on the eye test chart. Now, in the case of farsightedness, this is the situation where the cornea is flatter than it ought to be. As a result, it doesn't have enough focusing power of the light, and light misses the retina and focuses long. It focuses behind. Now, the further behind the retina that it focuses, the more farsighted you are. Now, in the case of farsightedness, the eye does have a response that means it can compensate through a process that we call accommodation to allow you to be able to see and get back some of that clarity. It does this through the second lens in the eye called the crystalline lens. The crystalline lens can respond to light focusing behind the eye by changing shape through a process that we call accommodation that then shifts the light focusing behind the eye further forward and onto the retina, as long as it's not too far behind and not too much work for the lens to have to do. It can do this and mean then that you can still get good vision. And as a result, that's why people who are farsighted can often find that the term farsightedness doesn't explain what they're seeing in real world situations. So whereas farsight is supposed to mean that you have sight for far distances, as a result, you can absorb quite a lot of farsightedness before you start to have any real problems focusing on objects close up and further away. Now, generally speaking, the reason that farsightedness is described as having sight for far distances and then struggling close up is because accommodation is really reserved for your focusing power close up. Now, when we all come to read or look at objects close up, we get a natural shift of light for backwards anyway, so it falls behind the eye so that we can focus on objects close up. And in this situation, the crystalline lens would normally kick in to accommodate, to adjust for you. Now, if you're really farsighted and the crystalline lens is having to overcome your farsightedness, it then has a huge amount of extra work to do because it first has to overcome your farsightedness and then it has to do the normal amount of accommodation that it needs to do for looking at objects close up. And this can often be such a big workload for the crystalline lens that then people who are farsighted may find that they struggle seeing close up, or their vision goes blurry, or they get eye strain just because of the workload that this lens is now under in order to help you to see objects close up. So for farsighted people, it can be more strenuous on your eyes looking at things close up rather than things further away. And as a result, for the most part, and generally speaking, farsightedness is easier on your eye when you're looking at things further away rather than when you're looking at objects close up. Now, with that in mind, you might be thinking, why do people with nearsightedness have the ability to see close up? And that's a good question. And it's really for the reason that I mentioned before. Every time we look at an object close up, we get a natural shift of light backwards. If you're someone that's farsighted, this means that you get a shift of light further back behind the eye, which adds to the workload of the crystalline lens. But if you're someone who's nearsighted, you actually get the situation where light is coming closer to the retina, and that actually makes things clearer for you to see. And it may be that this shift of light backwards in the case of nearsighted people results in the light focusing very close to the retina or on the retina, but in some cases it may even fall behind, and in which case the crystalline lens may be able to help you out with a little bit of accommodation so you can still see perfectly well. And that's the reason why people who are nearsighted tend to do very well and may never need reading glasses, because at the point where other people start to have problems with their manual focusing, they will still be able to read and see well close up through most of their life. And again, that depends on how short-sighted or how nearsighted you are to begin with. So now for my tip of the day. Remember that there's a difference between being farsighted, nearsighted, and having presbyopia. A lot of commentators or bloggers I often come across confuse them and often describe the process of being presbyopic, which is the age-related reduction in your autofocusing ability. They confuse that as you growing farsighted. But you have to keep the terms separated. So farsighted and nearsighted refers to the impact on the cornea, which is the error in how the cornea is shaped and how it focuses on the retina. And presbyopia, which is the error in your focusing ability, which affects the crystalline lens further in from the cornea. Often this leads to the confusion because these commentators are describing presbyopia as being you developing farsightedness, when it's not. It may appear like a type of farsightedness, but really you have to think of these things as separate because they impact a different lens. So as I said, the cornea is to do with your farsight and your general vision further away, and the crystalline lens is to do with your focusing ability and seeing things close up to you. So I hope that makes sense and clears up some of the confusion for you. Now, my question for you today is, what's your biggest challenge when it comes to being farsighted and nearsighted? Leave a message for me in the comments section below. Also, check out the description box for resources and information on what we've talked about today. If you found this video helpful at all, then please consider subscribing to the channel, hitting the like button, and also that notification bell as well. That way you get reminded every time I release a new video. I thank you for watching, and I look forward to seeing you in the next video. Take care.